Hi, today I'm going to discuss the refrigeration question in level 5 of thermodynamics assignment. So actually this is the question, the refrigeration question of level 5 thermodynamics. As you can remember, it is given that specifications of a vapor compression refrigerator system given below, right? Like majority of the students, they have not answered well, right? So it is very poor answering. So that's why I thought to discuss this. Right, so this is level 5 thermo, right? This level 5 thermo. So now let's see how to answer this question. So now the first thing is you need to sketch the refrigeration cycle, right? Okay, now let's sketch the refrigeration cycle. So now we can start with the compressor. Okay. And then compressor is directed to condenser. Okay, and then it is directed to expansion valve. And then after it is directed to evaporator. Right, and then again evaporator is connected to compressor. Now this is a closed circuit. So now what you need to know is you need to know the status of the refrigerant at each and every of these steps, right? Okay, so now let's see, no need to memorize because you can't do thermodynamics by memorizing. So now let's see, what do you have after compressor? Usually why we use a compressor? To press something, to compress something. So after compressor, what you will be having is high pressure. What you will be having is high pressure and high temperature vapor. Okay, after compressor, high pressure, high temperature vapor, right? So then after compressor, it is directed to the condenser. So condenser, actually, you know, it removes heat, right? Condensing or taking liquid out, right? So this actually removes heat, because to this you are giving high pressure, high temperature vapor, then it will output liquid, right? Condensing, right? Turning into water. So then after this process, again you need to know the status, right? So the status would be, so now be very careful, status would be here also high pressure, right? So pressure will not actually reduce, this is also high pressure, okay, but it's this is also high temperature, right? This is also high temperature, because the reason, now don't think the liquid that you are getting after condenser process that you can touch, right? Like don't think the liquid that you will be getting after this condenser process is at a temperature that where you can touch easily, right? It's not the case at all. He also high pressure and he also high temperature, but keep in mind this pressure is lesser than this pressure and this temperature is lesser than this temperature, right? So but ideally you can consider this pressure and this pressure as same. Okay, so let's get back to the point again. So here I told you this is a compressor, so target of the compressor is to produce high pressure, high temperature vapor, right? So high pressure, high temperature vapor, so then it is directed to the condenser, right? So condenser is a kind of a, you know, heat removing process, because finally you will be getting liquid. But here the most important part is what will happen to this pressure, what will happen to this temperature. Keep in mind, so actually ideally nothing will happen to the pressure, pressure will be still high pressure, okay? And So now when you are going to talk about the temperature, now here also high temperature, right? Actually, like more than saying high temperature, so here you can say it's like medium temperature, right? You can call this medium temperature because here also the temperature is high, right? That doesn't mean you can easily touch the liquid after the condenser process. Here also temperature is high, but lesser than this temperature. So if this temperature is T1 and if this temperature is T2, so both T1 and T2 are actually very high, but T2 is actually, you know, it is less than T1, right? So that is the important part over there, right? Because you won't be able to do refrigeration type problems if you can't understand the status, right? So then after that you have the expansion valve. So expansion valve means like this will do some kind of a work, right? Expanding, that is why we name it as expansion valve. So now, so what you will be getting after the expansion valve? So it will be definitely after expansion valve, if it will be definitely lower temperature, right? It will be definitely lower temperature and also lower pressure. Because now I'm saying why low pressure means now after doing a work, the pressure will be less, right? Right. So you can you remember that we were doing expansion of the turbine, something like, I mean, like when we were doing problems related with, you know, diesel cycle and petrol cycle, right? So as you know, after expansion, the pressure will be high because now it has done a work, right? So expansion valve means something that it is made to do a kind of a work. So after expansion valve process, definitely pressure will be high because it is doing a kind of a work. Because I think you might have done a lot of related examples in expansion processes. Usually if you consider temperature and entropy diagram, so this is how you are going to represent the expansion, because this will be like turbine input, right? So this will be turbine output, right? Because after doing, now this is happening, of course this is happening at the same entropy, but anyhow, in a turbine process, right, the initial pressure would be very high, right? Initial pressure would be very high. Okay, so after doing that particular work, the pressure would be very less. Understand? Right. So that's why we are telling, like, that's why we are using that formula for the expansion. You can remember what is the formula for isentropic expansion. So you can say T2 over T1 is equal to P2 over P1 to the power gamma minus 1 over gamma. So this is something else. Okay, so now here after expansion valve, as you know, it is doing a kind of a work, so pressure would be less and temperature also would be very less, right? Temperature would be very less. So now later we have what you call this evaporator. Evaporator means this is doing some sort of a hidden work. So what do you mean by hidden work? Hidden work means evaporator is something which is actually doing a kind of a, you know, status removal. That means evaporation, right? So this will convert the refrigerant here at liquid state into the refrigerant at vapor state, right? So this will do a kind of a, how to say that, this will do a kind of a phase change. So here the refrigerant, right? So here the refrigerant is at liquid state, liquid. So it will convert that liquid state refrigerant into vapor state refrigerant. So then what can you say about the status? Will the temperature rise or will the pressure rise? No. Guys, actually, here also, in very simply you can say, here also it will be low temperature. And pressure also will be low pressure. Pressure also will be low pressure, right? So here what you have is, I think you can see temperature. Okay, so I'll write again, low pressure, low temperature, right? Low pressure, low temperature what? Vapor. Right? So he also same, I mean before the evaporate also, it's the same, like those are the same conditions, low temperature and low pressure, but here what you have is actually liquid, right? So I think now you can understand this cycle properly, because understanding the vapor compression cycle is the hardest thing, because if you can understand the cycle, the others are actually nothing, right? So I think I don't need to repeat again. So, but doesn't matter, I will again summarize. So if you consider vapor compression refrigeration cycle, because there are a lot of refrigeration cycles, such as, you know, water refrigeration and jet refrigeration, air refrigeration, so there are a lot of refrigeration cycles. So this is what we talk about now, is vapor compression refrigeration cycle. So now here, now you need to sketch the components, which is the compressor and condenser, then expansion valve, then the evaporator. So now you need to study the status, that means like how the refrigerant is going to behave, right? So compressor, so let's start from compressor, because guys, it is easy. So what is the target of the compressor? We are using compressor to compress something. So after compressing, what you would be getting is something at very high pressure, and after compressing, temperature also will be high. So what do you have? What is the status? It will be vapor, right? So then it is directed to condenser. Condenser is some sort of a heat removing thing, or some sort of a liquidizing agent, because this will ultimately convert whatever given to this into a liquid. So here, after this condenser process, what you will be having is a liquid, right? What you will be having, it's a liquid. What are the status? Temperature also will be high temperature, but more than telling this high temperature, you better say medium temperature. Now I told you, you can also say high temperature, because guys, this temperature also very high, but more than high, so let's call it medium temperature, right? Medium temperature, right? So if this is T2, this T2 is less than T1. And what about the pressure? Guys, nothing will happen to the pressure, right? So let's think, ideally pressure is the same, right? Pressure is same as high pressure, right? Okay, so after that, then this is directed to the expansion valve. Expansion valve means it is something like a, how to say that, something like an expansion process, right? That's why I told you something little bit similar to that, you know, expansion thing that we deal in diesel petrol cycles. Okay, so here expansion valve means it is going to do something, expanding. So after expanding, what will happen to the final pressure? It will become less. So it will be, after expansion, it will be lower pressure, right? So then also, after doing a work, what will happen to the temperature? Temperature also will become less, right? So after expansion valve, you have low temperature, low pressure, what? Liquid. Nothing will happen to the status, so it will be the liquid. Then it is finally directed to this evaporator, right? So evaporator is a thing, something doing a very hidden work. So what is the hidden work? Something like a latent heat related work, latent thing. So evaporator converts the same liquid which is at here to vapor. So liquid at here, it will convert to vapor. So what are the conditions? Conditions will be same as here, guys. So what we give to evaporator is low temperature refrigerant. So after evaporator process also, what we have is low temperature refrigerant. So again, what we give to the evaporator is low pressure liquid. So what you have after the evaporator also consisting of low pressure what? Vapor, right? So to evaporator we give liquid, after evaporator we get vapor. Conditions will be the same, low temperature will also be low temperature, low pressure will also be same as low pressure. So I think now that is the refrigeration cycle. That is the hardest thing that you need to understand. So I think that part is done. So I took so long time to explain you what is refrigeration, vapor compression refrigeration cycle. So now, so let's come back to the problem actually. So I don't know where the video will end, right? So let's see, let's see. So let's do the videos even by part by part. So now this is question number 5, right? Can you see the rest? It's a bit not clear. Okay, I think now it's okay. Now you can see the rest. Okay, so now this is the refrigeration problem. Oh god. Okay, now this is the refrigeration problem. Level 5 thermostat, question number 5. So now let's take a look at the data they have given. Specifications of a vapor compression refrigeration system are given below, because many people were, like many students were just complaining that this is running out of missing data, some data are missing. No guys, none of the data are missing, right? All data, all necessary data actually given. So now let's see, because the fact is, like, you won't be able to do this problem if you don't understand the refrigeration cycle, right? So that's the fact. Okay, so let's take a look. Condensing temperature. So now I am going to explain you the important of each and every these hints, because they have given us like lot of hints, right? So they have given us lot of hints. So now let's try to understand the meaning of each and every these hint. So first thing is the condensing temperature. So what is condensing temperature? Condensing temperature means the temperature where the condensing process starts, right? That's the condensing temperature. The temperature where the condenser wants to start or initiate its process. Because you need to understand the words, the English words. So, right. So then that's the condensing temperature. Then evaporating temperature. So what is evaporating temperature? Evaporating temperature is the temperature where the evaporation process starts. So that's the evaporating temperature. Next thing, temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve. Okay, temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve. That means the temperature where the throttle valve process starts. What is throttle valve, guys? It is same as the expansion valve. Okay, so here I have mentioned something called, you know, throttle valve. So that throttle valve will be same. I mean, like, it's not different. The throttle valve will be same as here what we learned as expansion valve over here. So that means temperature condition for throttle valve also given. That means where the expansion valve process starts, the starting state of the expansion valve, right? Expansion valve. Okay. And the next thing is condition of the refrigerant before leaving the evaporator coil. So this bit kind of like complicated. Condition of the refrigerant before leaving evaporator coil. So now evaporator coil means that's the evaporator, right? So evaporator coil means the evaporator. So temperature condition before leaving, that means as it is within the evaporator process, what would be the condition of the refrigerant? Or else just skip this for a moment, right? Just skip this for a moment. Sometimes you might find a kind of a doubt in understanding this. Condition of the refrigerant before leaving evaporator coil. Before leaving evaporator coil means before leaving the evaporator. Maybe still it is within the, that means like before leaving means still it might be within the process, or just leave it for a little while. It's okay. Condition of the refrigerant after compression process. Condition of the refrigerant after compression process. That I already discussed with you, right? That means what would be the condition of the refrigerant after it is compressed, right? So here I already told you about the compressor. So what would be the final state of the refrigerant after compressing? So here they have mentioned condition of the refrigerant after compression was superheated vapor. Okay, so here what we'll be having is something in superheated state, right? So that is the condition of the vapor after the compression process. Okay, so then temperature rise of the condensed cooling water. Guys, temperature rise of the condensed cooling water, guys, let's just leave it, because now you don't need this data to sketch the refrigeration cycle, right? Because our target, our first target is to like sketch refrigeration cycles. That is the hardest part. So to sketch that, we don't need this data. We need this data in order to answer these requested questions, because now at the end of, after giving these specifications, they are asking some calculations, right? So in order to answer these calculations, we need this 12 degree Celsius data. Okay, so up to now just leave it, it's okay. And refrigerant flow rate also leave it, because all these data you need after completing the cycle, right? So till then you don't need, right? So then so now especially I need to tell you something. These two data are the most very important parts, right? So here actually they have given us enthalpy of refrigerant liquid at -10 and 45. Guys, so be very careful. Enthalpy of the refrigerant liquid, so here very important, they have given us the status of liquid, right, at two different temperatures. So what the hell is that? Enthalpy of same state at two different liquids, so it's very important. So now you need to understand at what process you have the same state at two different temperatures. You understand, guys? So you have to like give some sort of a special focus, right? You have to do some sort of very special focusing on these two data, because these two data are very important. Enthalpy of refrigerant liquid, okay, same status at two different. So now you need to know at what particular process you have the same status at two different temperatures. And so the same thing will happen to here also. Enthalpy of refrigerant vapor at -10 and 45, that means enthalpy of the same thing. What is the same thing? Vapor, but at two different temperatures. Why they have given two different temperatures? Very important. And the next thing, specific heat capacity of refrigerant as it leaves the condenser. Very important. So now guys, again you have to focus why they have given specific heat capacity. Usually in our calculations, right, so usually in our calculations we give specific heat capacity at constant pressure, right? So usually we give specific heat capacity at this particular temperature, right? So there is a reason for that, right? So the reason would be, there's a very clean reason: specific heat capacity of the refrigerant as it leaves the condenser. So this is something related with the condenser process, so that is why they have given this specific heat capacity as it leaves the condenser. That means still there's a kind of a doubt. We don't know whether this is at CP or whether this is at CV, right? CP CV issue is there. Okay, so doesn't matter, leave it. Then assume specific heat capacity of superheated vapor. Again they have given something specific heat capacity, right? Something like CP or CV like thing, right? So again they have given this at what status? At vapor. Okay, let's see why they have given that. Usually, as you can remember, we are using the CP, the specific heat capacity at constant pressure, times say for an example T2 minus T1. We are using this to find some sort of a heat release or heat input, right? Again, as you can remember, CP times T2 minus T1, usually we are using this formula to find some certain energy input or energy release from some sort of a system for a particular constant 1 kilogram of the substance, right? So like that, he also, they have given some specific heat capacity values. He also specific heat capacity at two different status, here for superheated vapor, here for refrigerant as it leaves the condenser, right? So just keep these two in your mind, right? And specific heat capacity of water, okay, just take this also. And they have given the specific heat capacity of water also. Actually this data you will never need to sketch the diagram, okay? So now I hope you can understand the analyzing of the data, right? So now we are moving to the hardest part, sketching the refrigeration cycle. That's the most hardest. Okay, so now sketch it. So now we clearly need to understand all these data in order to sketch the refrigeration cycle diagram. So right, so now we are moving to the most critical part. So let's make a mark on the video length, so I have to stop it at here. So very important, because many people were like, they were telling the given temperature values are wrong, right? So some people, actually I tell you one thing that most of the students told, because here what I have given is for 45 degrees Celsius, right? Here enthalpy of the refrigerant liquid I have given for minus 10 and 45 degrees Celsius, but many students, they told that minus 10 is fine, but here this should not be given to 35, this should be given for 35, because T08 kelvins means 35 degrees Celsius, right? 308 kelvin means 35 degrees Celsius, but many students, like they told me, this should not be given to 45, this should be given to 35. So no guys, this is correct, right? Okay, so now let's sketch. Marking is okay, right? So now I'm going to sketch the vapor compression refrigeration chart. Vapor compression refrigeration chart, right? In what sort of a diagram? So let's call it temperature. So let's call it temperature and entropy, right? T and S, you can also call it phi. That's the most hardest, right? So now if you have the assignment, look at your data value. Okay, so I'll take the assignment out because I also need to look at the data now. So I'll keep the assignment in here in front of me, right? So I'll keep the sheet here. It's a very important part. So now we are moving to the most critical part. Okay, so now we are going to sketch the variation of temperature with entropy for the given specifications of the refrigeration cycle. So let's see. I don't know where this video will end. Okay, so first thing is the compressor process. First thing will be the compressor process, right? So now be very careful. I have already shown you the cycle, right? I think it's better to sketch the cycle again. Okay, I will sketch it quickly, otherwise sometimes you will not understand. Here compressor, and here condenser, and here expansion valve, and here evaporator. And here you have evaporator, okay, because you need this diagram also. Okay, right, so compressor, condenser, expansion and evaporator. Okay, so let's go. So now first process is the compressor process, right? So now you have to focus on what we give to compressor and what we will be getting after compressor. So this compressor is a kind of an adiabatic process, right? Compressor is a kind of an adiabatic process. That means there is no heat transfer taken in this process. So now we are going to sketch the compressor process. Because why? Compressor is something, a pressing thing, like some sort of a compressive action. So this is a kind of an adiabatic process. So adiabatic process means like no heat transfer, I mean delta entropy, no change in entropy, right? So delta phi is equal to zero, compressing, right? So you are going to compress something, right? So when the compression happens, so it happens at the same entropy level. So after compressing, what will happen? Definitely the temperature will increase, because this is the temperature axis, after compressing, definitely the temperature will rise. So this is how you are going to denote the compressor process, right? So here to here, this is the compressor process. So now in this problem, the compression process is actually occurred up to some certain temperature, right? So that is a fact. So now in this problem, it says condensing temperature is 375. That means condensing temperature, again I will take that chart, the circuit diagram. So now please focus that condensing beginning or the input to the condenser is equal to the output from compressor. So that means, in other language, if we say end of compressor process, right, end of compressor process is equal to what? Beginning of condenser process. End of compressor process is equal to the beginning of the condenser process. So now this is our compression process. So now we don't know up to what point this compression process occurs. So in the question, now it is clearly said condensing temperature is 375 Kelvin, because now I told you the hardest thing is to obtain this TS chart. So for that only we are giving this much of hard efforts. So now here the compression process happens. What is this? This is a adiabatic compression which occurs at constant entropy level, which is phi. So now this occurs up to 375 Kelvin. Why 375 Kelvin? Because condensing process starts at 375. Okay, so that means that is the end of compression, right? And then, so now after compressor process, what do you have? Condenser process. So now we know this is the beginning of condenser. This is the beginning of condenser. So now we need to find the end of the condenser process, right? So for that we need to find the given data for us, because in this question paper they have told us all necessary data. So now clearly find, so now we need to find the condenser output. So how to find that? Condensing temperature is there, evaporating is there. So now you know after condenser what you are going to meet is the expansion valve. After condenser you will meet expansion valve. So in this problem they have mentioned temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve. So what is throttle valve? That is same as expansion valve. So temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve, so that means that is the input to the throttle. So input to the throttle means that is the condenser output, right? So now we know condenser input. What is condenser input? That is compressor output. So now we need to find what is condenser output. So condenser output is equal to the input to expansion valve. So I will write that again. So condenser output is equal to the expansion valve input. So what is that temperature? Temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve, 308. I think 308 Kelvin means, I think it must be 35 degrees Celsius. Okay, so let's sketch that temperature point over here, but don't mark anything. Okay, so now it's so complicated now. So now we need to plot this, we need to plot the rest. So now as you know, temperature condition for the entry of throttle value is this much, and they have given data for us for this 45. So that is the biggest problem. Understand, guys? So now in this problem there are some cases. Now see, they have given for the same status of the refrigerant enthalpy for two different temperatures. Can you understand that? For the same status, right? For the same status, which is liquid. Okay, for the same status of the refrigerant, the enthalpy value of two different temperatures. And here also, for the same status of the refrigerant, which is vapor, the enthalpy is given for two different temperatures. So, and guys, and also you can say, as in the same manner, you can say enthalpy for the same temperature in two different states. So method number one, you can say same status to different temperatures. And the second case you can say, which is also same as the previous, same temperature, the enthalpy value for same temperature for two different states. So now you have to think why they have given us that data, right? So why they have given that? So that is the point you need to worry about. So there's a reason why they have given us the data. So that means, so our ultimate target is to plot, right? So our ultimate target is to plot that TS diagram. So now see, now here, what is the, now this is the end of the compression process. So now here, what is the status of the refrigerant? See, condition of the refrigerant after compression process. This is very important. See, condition of the refrigerant after compression process is superheated. See, here you can see superheated. So here what you have is superheated, right? So here at the end of compression, what you have is superheated. So now what is the ultimate target? So we need to plot the HS curve up to the throttle valve. So now you need to worry about what you actually have at the throttle valve. So like, so now you need to worry what is the status that you have at the throttle valve. So now this is the throttle valve, right? So this is the throttle valve. So what is the input to the throttle valve? So it's a liquid, right? So input to the throttle valve is always a liquid. Okay, and now you have to reconsider the other data also, because sketching this is very complicated. So now here they have mentioned us enthalpy of the refrigerant liquid minus 10 and 45, enthalpy of the refrigerant minus 10 and 45 vapor. Oh, so now see, here at this point here at this point we have vapor of 375 kelvins, right? So now we need to sketch this up to this level, or up to this temperature. So how we can do that? Because this point is already containing, right? Or this point already contains the higher amount of energy due to vapor state. So first of all, guys, you need to reduce that, right? So at this point you already have lot of vapor energy, because now here the status of the refrigerant is not saturated, it's a superheated vapor. So here you have superheated vapor. So first of all, you have to like reduce this up to 45 degree vapor. That is why they have given this. Now because now like just because here they have mentioned temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve, right? So that is the point, like most of the students ask that doubt from me, like many students, they just asked. So like here temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve is 308, right? temperature condition for the throttle value is 35 degrees Celsius. So why have they given this value for 45? So this also should get corrected to 35. No, keep in mind that's not the case at all, right? So this data is given for a reason, because first of all, the superheated energy level, which is at 375 Kelvin energy, right, because this system already containing superheated energy at 375 Kelvin, so that energy should gently get reduced, right? That energy should gently get reduced up to 45, right? So what do you have at 45? Still vapor. Here what do you have? Superheated vapor. So here what do you have? Okay, that is also a vapor, but this vapor is saturated vapor, right? So this vapor is saturated vapor, and this is the saturated line. Okay, so this is the saturated line. So now they have given, so that is the reason, that is the reason why they have given enthalpy for 45 degree vapor. No, there is a reason why they have given us the data for 45 degree vapor and 45 degree liquid, because now here there is a state change process happens, because it is the condenser, because usually in the condenser, right? So like to the condenser we give vapor and it returns liquid, right? We give vapor and it returns liquid. So here the superheated energy gently gets reduced to 45 degree vapor, right? So superheated 375 Kelvin superheated refrigerant energy gently reduced up to 45 degree vapor, and then again along the same temperature the energy is reduced up to what? Same temperature liquid, right? Energy is reduced up to same temperature liquid. Is that the end? No, that is the most hardest part in this kind of problems in order to teach somebody, because our ultimate target is 35, not 45, right? Because our condenser output is not 45, condenser output is 35. So for that there is a kind of a process, there is a kind of a flow. So how we are going to like figure out what is that related process? By considering the given data, guys. So that is why it is hard. So 45 degree vapor now is reduced. Now the, see, the entropy, the energy level is reduced. So now 45 degree vapor is reduced up to what? 45 degree liquid. And 45 degree liquid energy you can reduce up to 35 degree liquid, right? 45 degree liquid now you can reduce to, so let's call this point, that point, 45 degree liquid, now it's reduced to this point. So what is this point? What is this point? That is 35 degree liquid. So that is the case, right? I will again sketch this, guys, so don't worry. 45 liquid is reduced to 35 liquid. So what is this point? 35 degree liquid. And after that what? So now this is the end of condenser. This point is the end of condenser, and also you can say input to the expansion valve, right? So now what is the next thing? So now guys, see, evaporating temperature is given. So now focus, now in this problem they have given evaporating temperature. So guys, what is evaporating temperature? So see, evaporating temperature they have given as minus 10 degree Celsius, guys. Evaporating temperature minus 10 degree Celsius, I mean this one, right? So this is minus 10 degree Celsius. So now actually evaporating temperature is the temperature where the evaporating, where the evaporation process begins. Evaporating temperature means the temperature where the evaporation process starts. So in other words, the place where the evaporation starts is what? The end of expansion valve. Understand? So process where the evaporation starts. Process where the evaporation starts, right? So this expansion process ends at here. So that is the beginning or the next input to the evaporation process at here. So then, now here we have 35 degree liquid, right? So now that energy is reduced. That energy is reduced to what? Minus 10 degree liquid. Okay, minus 10 degree liquid. So that's how it goes. So you can sketch this not in this kind of a curve, you can sketch it like this, right? So I'll sketch it again. So anyhow, this energy is now reduced to up to this point, like minus 10 degree liquid, right? It will come like this. So now what is this? This point is the end of this point is the end of expansion valve, right? Or in other words, input to evaporator, right? So now the next thing is, what is evaporator? So evaporator is what we call, that is also doing a kind of a latent heat change. That means evaporator converts what you have in the liquid form into vapor. So now for that we again need to find, so what is the final process of, I mean, what is the final stage of the evaporator? So for that we need to find these data, like see, condition of the refrigerant, no. Right. So now they have given, right, evaporating temperature they have given. So evaporating temperature means, see again this part, the evaporating temperature means process where the evaporation begins, right? So that is the process where the evaporation begins. So actually evaporation means converting the same temperature, what you have at them, converting something at the same temperature into the same temperature thing in a different state. So here what you have, minus 10 liquid, here you have minus 10 liquid. So it will convert this minus 10 liquid thing into what? Minus 10 vapor, right? So that's how the circuit actually completes, right? So that's how the circuit actually completes. So you have to be very careful, right? So doesn't matter, I will again teach you, it's no problem, right? So I will again give a recap part, right? So now you are familiar with all the necessary given data, right? So now I will tell you, this is temperature and this is our entropy, okay? So now I will again sketch the refrigeration circuit over here. This is compressor, okay, and this is condenser, right? Compressor, condenser, and this one expansion valve, or in other words you can say throttle valve. So and then it is directed to evaporator, right? This is the evaporator, and then it is connected to compressor and the circuit completes, right? And so now you clearly know the individual status of the refrigerant at each these cases. Now you know what is the status of the pressure, status of the temperature, and the status of the refrigerant at each of these cases, because I already explained you that, right? So now focus the given data. So when sketching this circuit, you need to start from one particular point, right? So you need to start from somewhere. So let's start from the compression process. So compression process is a kind of a constant entropy process, because there is no change in the entropy. I mean, that is a kind of an adiabatic process. So this is the compression process. This is the beginning of compression. This is beginning of compression, and this is end of compression. End of compression. So how we know this is end of compression? Because in the problem, it is clearly told, right? So they have clearly told to us condensing temperature is 375, right? So they have clearly told condensing temperature is 375, because condensing temperature is the end of compression process. End of compression or compression output is equal to condenser input. So now, in order to satisfy that, the compression process should end at here. So at this point, so what is the temperature? That is 375 Kelvin. And the next thing is, the next thing that we need to know is, at what particular point the condenser process ends, because it's really very difficult to like scan or to catch up these words. So now, in order to catch that, so now carefully see temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve. That means they have given the input temperature to the expansion valve. I'm again telling, they have given the input temperature to the expansion valve. So input temperature to the expansion valve is equal to what? Condenser output, right? Condenser output is equal to the right output from here is equal to the expansion valve input. So now it is somewhere at here. Don't sketch it. So they have clearly told us temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve is 35 degrees Celsius. That means 308. So here just put that temperature 308 Kelvin and just mark it as a point. Now there is a problem. So now consider, I told you they have given us two enthalpy values. One is for there are four enthalpy values, right? So in first case, they have given us the enthalpy of the liquid, right? They have given us the enthalpy of the liquid for two different temperatures, and they have given us the enthalpy of vapor for two different temperatures. So now we have to think as why they have given that. So you know, here the compression process is actually processed, or the compression process is actually carried up to 375 Kelvin, right? So what is the status of the thing that you have after the compression? This is a superheated vapor. So now superheated vapor is, now you need to sketch. Now you gently need to sketch this curve starting from here. You can't just jump off as you want. So here you have 375 Kelvin high temperature, like a superheated vapor. So now just focus. Here they have given enthalpy of refrigerant vapor at minus 10 and 45. So I mean, like, which part is having the highest amount of energy? Minus 10, 45. Okay, so more than the liquid, right? More than the liquid, highest energy is stored in the vapor. So that means this 375 Kelvin highly heated, superheated vapor is little bit reduced to what? 45 degree Celsius. Okay, so that is why they have given the enthalpy of the refrigerant vapor at 45 degree, right? So this higher amount of superheated vapor energy is gently reduced to 45 degree, or in other words, 45 degree means how much? 318 Kelvin. This is gently reduced to 45 degree vapor. So now here, if you want, you can sketch this curve. What is this curve? This is the saturated curve. Okay, and now again they have told us, now because now you have to come in a flow, right? You have to come this in a flow. It is like you have 375 Kelvin super heated vapor, right? 375 Kelvin superheated vapor, and then it is gently reduced to what? 318 Kelvin saturated vapor. Okay, 318 Kelvin saturated vapor, and that is further reduced to same temperature saturated. If this is vapor, it is further reduced to, because now the heat energy should get reduced in a gentle manner, right? It should reduce gently. So this is now being reduced to 380 Kelvin saturated liquid. Okay, so now this same, I mean the same temperature that you have here, right? Okay, the same temperature thing that you have here is now gently reduced to 45 degree what? Liquid. Okay, so now we need to skip this point. But finally, what is our ultimate point? To obtain the expansion valve point, right? Temperature condition for the entry of throttle valve. Okay, so now here you have 45 degree liquid, and now it is gently reduced to 35 degree liquid. Here you have 45 degree liquid, it is gently reduced to 45 degree liquid. So what is this point? This point is 35 degree liquid. Okay, so done. So what is this point? This is the input to the expansion valve, right? Input to the expansion valve. So how we are going to sketch the next? Let's see. So now again read. So now again look at the given data. Now they have told evaporating temperature minus 10, right? What? So now they have told here, shall we complete the circuit? 375 Kelvin superheated vapor, then it is reduced to 318 Kelvin saturated vapor, then it is reduced to 318 Kelvin saturated liquid, then it is reduced to 308 Kelvin liquid. Okay, 308 Kelvin liquid. What liquid? Refrigerant liquid. Okay, so now they have told us evaporating temperature. That means now they have told us the input temperature condition to the evaporator, right? Input temperature condition. So this is the input. Now they have told an input condition to the evaporator. So input to the evaporator is the output of the expansion valve. So now here you have 35 degree liquid, right? So that again you have to reduce to this point. This you have to reduce to this point. So what is this point? That is minus 10 degree Celsius liquid, right? This is minus 10 degree Celsius liquid. So this point is the end of expansion valve, or in other words, input to the evaporator, right? Input to the evaporator. So now this is also done. So now if you input something to the evaporator, so what is the ultimate target of the evaporator? Evaporator means like something that evaporates, right? Evaporator means something that evaporates at the same particular temperature thin to a same temperature output at a different state. For an example, if you give something to the evaporator which is at, say for an example, now I'm talking about ideal evaporator, okay? Ideally, guys, right? Sometimes there can be like errors due to heat losses, but ideally, to evaporator, ideally, if you consider evaporator, right? So if you give something to the evaporator, say for an example, minus 10 degree liquid. So if you give minus 10 degree liquid to the evaporator, so it will output minus 10 degree vapor, right? So you are giving minus 10 degree liquid, and this outputs minus 10 degree vapor. So what is now out? What is the output of the evaporator? output of the evaporator is equal to the what? Input to compressor. So now this is the point that we started to sketch the compressor process. So, right? And we also know that evaporator is something which is doing a latent heat transfer. Right? Evaporator is something that is doing a kind of an evaporative heat transfer or like a latent heat transfer. So now we know input to the evaporator is minus 10. So then it will output same temperature thing which is given to this one in a different format. So minus 10 degree liquid is given, so this will output minus 10 degree Celsius vapor. So I hope now you can understand. So for the better confirmation, I will again sketch it. So it's a kind of a heavy explaining process. So I think now you can sketch after many explanations, right? Temperature, right? Entropy, this is input to, sometimes my handwriting won't be clear, but I'm going to tell you each and every word in a clear format, right? So this is okay. I will name this point as one. This is one. What is this? Input to compressor, right? And it will go up to two. What is two? End of compressor. End of compressor. Or in other words, input to condenser. So now there is a kind of a process which takes place inside the condenser, right? So here we have minus 10 degree vapor. So better to include the temperature also. So here we have minus 10 degree vapor. Here we have what? At this point, what we have? 300, let's call it in Celsius. It doesn't matter. Let's put it in Kelvin. 375 Kelvin. Superheated vapor, right? So at point 2 you have 375 Kelvin superheated vapor, and that superheated vapor energy is gently reduced up to 45 degree Celsius vapor. This is not a process point, but let's call it as 45 degree Celsius saturated, 45 degree Celsius saturated refrigerant vapor, right? This higher amount of superheated vapor energy is now gently reduced up to 45 degrees Celsius saturated refrigerant vapor. That's 45, right? So now here what you have is 45 degrees Celsius vapor, and that is again gently the heat is reduced up to, right? Here what you have, 45 degrees Celsius saturated vapor, now it is gently reduced up to this point. I'm not going to put a name. So what is this point? 45 degree Celsius saturated refrigerant liquid. Okay, 45 degree Celsius saturated refrigerant liquid, and this point is further reduced to 35 degree Celsius refrigerant liquid, right? That is this point. Actually now this is the end of condenser process. So now you can recall it as 3. So now the entire thing which is happening, like the entire process which is happening throughout 2 to 3, right? So I'm going to hatch this like this. So what is this hatched path in red colored? So this is the condenser process, right? So now we can get a very clear idea. So the higher amount of superheated vapor energy, which is at point 2 at 375 Kelvin, is gently reduced to 45 degrees Celsius saturated vapor, right? So like that, there is a lone process like this. So now here, finally, what you have? 35 degrees Celsius refrigerant liquid. And the energy at here also reduced to, in this kind of a curve, and please guys, it's better if you study about the curve pattern, like, because you can't sketch the curves as you want. So now this energy is also reduced to how much? This point, right? This dot. So what is this dot? Is the ending point of this path where the 35 degrees Celsius refrigerant liquid is now reduced to minus 10 degree liquid, right? Minus 10 degree liquid. So this is point number 4. What is this? Point number 4. So what is point number 4? Evaporator input, right? So what is point number 4? Evaporator input. So now actually here what you have? Evaporator, right? This is the evaporator. So here at point 4 you have minus 10 degree liquid is now energy is reduced up to what? Minus 10 degree vapor, right? So this is the chart. I think now you can understand what is actually sketched in the model answer, right? Right, okay, so I'll just try to reduce it and see. Right, so now let's see. So can you understand this? Right, so this is the model answer. This is a sample extraction of the model answer. Actually this 1 to 2 is the compression process, right? This is minus 10 degrees Celsius refrigerant vapor, and this is 375 Kelvin superheated vapor, and then that energy is reduced up to this. So what is this point? 45 degrees Celsius saturated vapor, right? So here what you have, 45 degrees Celsius vapor is converted to what? 45 degree liquid. 45 degree liquid is reduced to 35 degree liquid. 35 degree liquid is reduced to minus 10 degree liquid. Minus 10 degree liquid is reduced to minus 10 degree vapor. Minus 10 degree vapor, 375 Kelvin, or in other words 102 degree Celsius superheated vapor. And here what you have, 45 degree Celsius or 318 Kelvin saturated vapor. And here what you have is 45 degree Celsius refrigerant liquid. And here what you have is 35 degree Celsius refrigerant liquid. Here what you have is minus 10 degree Celsius refrigerant liquid. So now that is the path. I think now you have a clear idea about the path. It's okay guys, now I think now doesn't matter. Now calculations are not kind of a problem, because but many students actually they have made mistakes in finding the COP factor, right? So finding or like applying values to the formula is easy now, right? So I will discuss that in next video. The most important thing that I wanted to do is to teach you guys how to sketch the curve, right? So how to sketch that curve, right? So this is the curve that we had a very hard effort to study. It is coming like this, then like this, then this, then this, then this, right? So this is the curve that we had a kind of very high effort. So I think you now have a clear understanding, right? So in next video we'll see how to answer these parts, right? Okay guys, thank you so much. Thanks, good luck.